Thank you. So good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies this morning. First agenda item for today is to continue taking evidence on the Gender Recognition Scotland Bill. And I welcome our first panel to the meeting, Paul Lowe, Register General for Scotland and Keeper of the Records of Scotland, National Records of Scotland, who is joining us virtually. James Kerr, Deputy Chief Executive, and Robert Strachan, Head of Strategy and Improvement, Scottish Prison Service, and Dr. Kevin Guyan, University of Glasgow. I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and can I ask our witnesses to make some short opening statements, starting with Paul Lowe, please.
Good morning, convener. Thanks very much for the invite to this session. I'll keep my remarks brief. My role as Registrar General will be to implement the elements of the legislation as they relate to my functions and the functions of NRS. NRS obviously has a very long tradition of dealing with similar life matters since the introduction of civil registration in 1855. We obviously administer the systems for births, deaths and marriage registration, and also adoptions, and more recently the regime around civil partnership. So we have a broad kind of experience in dealing with the different sensitivities and importance of these life events. So my role will be to execute the will of the Parliament and the terms of the legislation as they are ultimately passed. Happy to take any questions.
Okay, thank you very much. And now James Kerr, please.
Thank you, convener. I start this morning by thanking the committee for the invitation to attend today's meeting. Convener, committee members, I see today's meeting as an opportunity, one to reaffirm the Scottish Prison Service's commitment to creating a culture where equality of opportunity, diversity and human rights are actively valued and promoted, and where discrimination is not tolerated. To be clear about our commitment to progressing, protecting and promoting the rights of all of the people we care for in Scotland's prisons, to illustrate that our individualised risk assessment approach to the placement and management of those in our care does not conflict with our continuing strong commitment to advance equality and protect the rights of all, and is consistent with our wider commitment to the health, safety and well-being of the people who live and work in Scottish prisons. Also, to update the committee on the Scottish Prison Service policy review that is currently underway and the constructive engagement that has taken place so far with a range of stakeholders across communities of identity and interest, including staff and service users. Convener and committee members, the Scottish Prison Service is a rights-based public service. We play a distinctive role in Scottish society that we take extremely seriously. Not just safety and security, but public protection, supporting well-being, rehabilitation and reintegration. We know that we must play that role in a way in which it protects the rights of the individual and the rights of those around them. The individualised way in which we place and manage and care for transgender people is an example of how we do this, how we protect the rights of the individual and the rights of others. Moreover, we do so in a way in which does not conflate management of risk with gender identity. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Dr. Guyan, apologies for mispronouncing your surname earlier.
Convener. Decisions made about who to count, what to count and how to count are not value neutral, but bring to life a certain vision of the world around us. Data should reflect the vibrancy, the messiness, the ups and downs of our experiences. It should not define who we are or how we live our lives. Thank you, committee, for the invitation to present evidence today. I will focus my contribution on aspects of the bill related to the collection, analysis and use of data, as this reflects my expertise as a researcher, particularly in relation to LGBTQ data in Scotland. The vast majority of data collection exercises in Scotland across Scotland's public, private and voluntary sectors do not currently ask questions about an individual's legal sex. In other words, and in plain English, how someone answers a sex question in a survey or another data collection exercise is not contingent on whether or not that individual has a gender recognition certificate. Ahead of today's evidence session, I reviewed major data collection activities that involve the capture of information about sex, This included quantitative social research, reporting requirements for the Equality Act's public sector equality duty, gender pay gap reporting, crime and police records, and census data. All of these data collection activities follow a self-identification approach that acknowledges that individuals are best placed to describe themselves. Now, there's nothing radical about a self-identification approach to data. It's the status quo in social research and is used for all questions, for other questions on race, religion, sexual orientation, and disability. Those opposed to the bill, or those working to delay its passage through Parliament, cite concerns about data collection or the lack of existing data. I've witnessed through my work how demands for more and more data can operate as a stalling mechanism to stall meaningful action. The mention of data can obscure the topic under discussion and give credence to abstract concerns about policymaking and the law. Committee, contrary to claims we need more data, I believe we are drowning in data that demonstrates the need for reform. The proposal for a self-declaration system is not untested. It is happening today in many countries around the world and has been happening for the past 10 years. And although my work focuses on data, we cannot lose sight of the people behind the numbers. It's vital that we design data collection tools that are robust and inclusive, engaging as many people as possible. I therefore wish to reiterate that data collection activities in Scotland do not currently ask individuals to share information about the sex recorded on their birth certificate or GRC. With this fundamental point in mind, the bill will not impact the collection, analysis and presentation of data. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll now move on to questions, starting with Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning and for your opening remarks. If I can come, Paul, to you first, and just a question around the processing and assessing of applications for GRCs. Can you outline how you would go about it? Would it be merely accepting the statutory declaration at face value? What checks and balances would you envisage having in place?
The legislation is founded on the principle of that legal declaration and there being legal sanction for people who deliberately make fraudulent applications. So obviously we will design application processes and systems and ways of confirming some of the information that's passed to us, but it's not our role in the system unless there's evidence to the contrary to sort of contradict people satisfying the legislation and making those declarations to us. And obviously there's procedures envisaged in the legislation if either myself or my staff or others are concerned about an application that has been made through escalation to the Sheriff Court as well. So that would be an important additional protection and certainly one that if we had any concerns, we would be open to using ourselves.
Thanks very much for that, Paul. If I can just follow on from that, there will be conditions that need to be satisfied for any GRC application, and you will then be required to give information as to the effect of the GRC as per Section 3 of the bill. Can you tell us, have you determined what that information will include, what you will be looking for in that?
Not at this stage. I think we recognise also that the bill's at stage one and is liable to some changes potentially. So I think what we will do is we will design our processes and procedures and information to ensure it's compatible with the Act as passed by the Parliament. So we've started preliminary work looking at these issues, but I wouldn't say that we've got a concluded point on that yet.
Okay, thank you. I suppose just do you once the bill is at stage three, would that be when you would determine what that would be, and you would seek in any process? Would you seek clarification around any evidence required or anything like that? Yeah.
We're thanks for clarifying that. Yeah, we're working very closely with the Scottish Government and the policy teams devising this and the legislation, and there's regular dialogue between our teams on the practicalities of the system in relation to the policy and the legislation. And obviously there is the potential for some provision of regulations made by myself to add further detail if required. So I think there's something about us keeping in touch with how the legislation develops and evolving those issues as we go along. But I think it would be premature to say here's a definitive set of guidance or information that we would issue at this stage.
OK, thank you. That's helpful. I'll leave it there for now.
Thank you. And can we go to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for your opening statements. I find them really helpful. My first question is to Paul, if that's OK as well. And I wondered if you could set out what the effect of a statutory declaration is and also give another example or other examples of how they're used in Scotland today.
Thanks. Statutory declarations are used for a range of different application procedures. Obviously, when people marry, they make statutory declarations as an example, but many procedures, including when people apply for benefits or a range of other services, they're making a statutory declaration about their circumstances and the accuracy of that. And obviously, the bill, as currently formed, anticipates legal sanctions for people who make fraudulent declarations against a statutory declaration in this procedure.
On that particular point, do you think there is a need for the bill to include the offence, or is it already an offence in other legislation? Or do you have any understanding of why it's got that included in this particular bill?
I think there's general principles of criminal law around fraud, but it's not uncommon, in my experience, for there to be specific criminal sanctions in pieces of founding legislation in relation to applications. Whether it's marriage or whether it's in other forms of life. So I don't see it as unusual that it's included in this legislation. People make false declarations in marriage or other things. These are serious matters as well. So it feels relevant and proportionate to what we would see with other legislation, in my view.
Thank you. And on the point about the regulation that you mentioned earlier, could you give us an indication as to what kind of support and guidance you would be able to offer people who are applying for a gender recognition certificate? And have you had any conversations with the government around the guidance mentioned in the bill? And in particular, could you maybe comment on what additional support you would be able to offer 16 and 17-year-olds?
Thank you. I think it's important that we separate out two sources of advice and guidance. There's the advice and guidance to somebody who's taking decisions as to whether they are going to apply for a gender recognition certificate and to change their sex through that. And then there's the advice that you provide to somebody dealing with the process of applying for the certificate. So my role is not to replace the current medical panel or any, it's to establish an administrative system to allow people to apply legally to apply for a gender recognition certificate. So what I would say is the function of my organisation is to provide support and advice to people about the process and how they do it and support in doing so. It's not for us to provide advice and support about how they make important personal life decisions. What we would anticipate, though, is that there will be organisations out there who will be capable of providing personal support and advice to people who are struggling or want additional information on those elements. And that's the nature of the conversations that we're having with Scottish Government at the moment. So I would see it entirely compatible that if somebody was to apply to my organisation, that we would provide through our website, correspondence, various other routes, information of groups that they can access to provide them with advice on the broader issues of changing their sex. My organisation will, in addition, provide information about how the process works and what's required and how it works and what is the consequence of applying for and achieving a gender recognition certificate. So I think there's something about that core offer from us about the process, how it works, the consequences of it. And then there's a broader support wrapper, which is about the broader decision making for that individual and what that means and accessing support and advice. And I would see our role as NRS in signposting and linking people to that. I think it would be difficult if we were to try and cover both of those, as ultimately we're there to make independent decisions about applications, not to steer individuals in their personal decision making. In terms of 16 and 17 year olds, we're very conscious of the sensitivity around this issue as the bill was introduced. Our proposal would certainly be that for 16 and 17 year olds, we would offer phone and potentially face-to-face conversations with those individuals. Now, that would not be of an investigatory nature, that would be of a support nature. It would be optional. That individual would not need to take that offer up, but we would, as a matter of course, make that contact and make that offer as part of the process. Hope that helps.
Yes, it does. I have one further question, if that's okay, convener.
For Paul, yeah.
For Paul, yes. Yeah. Sorry, Paul.
Yeah, no, it's good.
Yes. That is very, very helpful. At what point do you think you would be giving people or signposting people to these organisations, and what kind of organisations are they? And secondly, have you considered, you mentioned there that you would give advice or you would give information on the consequences of a gender recognition certificate and changing your sex. Can you tell us a bit about what you expect that advice to look like?
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of your first point, I think there's still scope and need for conversations about what those organisations would be and how that support would be accessed. And that's areas that we're continuing to discuss with the Scottish Government. In terms of your latter point, I think there's something about people understanding the legal consequences of being given a gender recognition certificate. So that's predominantly where I'm coming from. So in the current process under the medical panel, NRS register in our gender recognition register decisions taken by the gender recognition panel. So we hold a register of people who've applied and achieved GRCs through the current process. And as part of that, we, as the organisation responsible for birth and adoption registration, we engage with those individuals and provide them with an outline of their new birth certificate or their new adoption extract certificate as part of showing them what that would look like and what that would involve before they're formally issued it. So I would see that there would be some engagement with individuals around their understanding of what achieving a GRC means in a legal context, but also in terms of what that means in relation to their birth and adoption certificate and how that information will be recorded.
Thank you. Thank you. I have no further questions for
you. Thank you. Go to Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Paul. I'd like to ask, in terms of people at the moment who are applying for a GRC, do you within the organisation have a process for feedback? And if you do, have you anything that you can tell us about that?
Sorry, was that question for me? Sorry.
Yes, Paul.
Yeah. Right, okay. Thanks. Yeah, I mean, we obviously engage with the current medical panel and other registrar generals across the UK on these matters. It's probably hard at our stage of the process because we're ultimately receiving an outcome, a decision that the panel have already taken after their consideration. And our involvement in the process is then more about recording that in the Scottish Register. And then liaising with those individuals in relation to their kind of revised birth or adoption certificates. So I probably don't have any specific unique insights NRS has on the process based on where we sit at the moment. I know that the committee have previously been given various sources of evidence and views from different groups on this, and certainly I would recognise and understand those views, but I don't think we've got anything new or additional or any kind of significant feedback that we get through our process at the present time, I'm afraid.
No problem. And can I just ask, in terms of staff training, and I know this is operational, but with the process of obtaining a GRC potentially becoming easier for people, and you might have more people coming forward, more work to deal with. Are staff trained and able to have that, you know, communications, appropriate communications with people?
Yeah, I mean, these are very important questions. I mean, there's obviously no hard formula for how many applications will result from this. I know the Scottish Government have done some modelling and, you know, anticipate somewhere in the order of 250, maybe 300 applications a year based on international experience. We will need to see. At the moment, we're basing our assumptions around that. We will appoint a small additional team, probably of 3 to 4 people, who will handle those. We'll obviously need to just keep track of what the volumes look like over time. Those individuals will receive training and support. I would say that it sits within a broader picture of the type of advice and support we have to provide to a range of people. So if I can provide a relevant example, in adoption, so we hold the sealed court records and decisions for adopted people in Scotland, and we have an adoptions team in place. So we have individuals who come to see us, and effectively we're opening court decision papers for the first time, and that individual seeing it. So in that scenario, we have private space. We have individuals who, you know, people can bring somebody to support them. The staff are trained to provide that support. Obviously, it can be a very emotive and difficult topic for those individuals. And again, we'll signpost people to other sources of advice, including Birthlink and various other things. So we do have staff who are familiar with dealing with those sorts of issues. We also have people who change their name, which can be quite an important and significant event in life, and providing them with support and advice around that. And we undertake the registration of celebrants, belief body celebrants, and new belief bodies. So we have to provide advice and support both to them and, you know, in those circumstances. So we have staff in this kind of registration space who undertake a broad range of duties, including dealing with local authority registrars and people going through the registration process. So while this is new, there are close parallels to other things that we already do.
Yeah. Great, thank you.
Just to let the witnesses know, we're kind of grouping the questions that we have just now, so it's not that all the questions are going to be for Paul, but I think a final sup for Paul from Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, convener. Yes, we'll come to you shortly. It just occurred to me, and I should have asked when I had my turn a minute ago, so forgive me to go back to a question that I asked you about. Do you expect the information that you give out on the basis of the consequences of a gender recognition certificate to change significantly after the legislation, or will it continue if the legislation was passed, or would it continue to be the same kind of information you're given just now on the effect of a GRC?
So at present we don't have that role. It's the medical panel and the committee that take the decision. So the information that's provided to individuals going through the gender recognition process at the moment is not something that NRS does. What we do is we receive the decision from the panel, who've either decided to agree or refuse an application. We then register that on our gender recognition register, and then work with the individual in relation to their birth certificate. So we're very much at the end of the current process. So it would be for the panel and for the current UK application process to kind of point out those, you know, the legislation and, you know, the importance and the significance of those events. So we don't do that at the moment, and this would be an area that we would need to build in the new process. And obviously it's important for people to understand when they're signing, for example, a declaration, the importance of that declaration, and indeed the potential sanctions that might exist if they were to make fraudulent declarations in their application.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. And Rachel Hamilton, further up.
Thank you, Mr. Lowe. It's a very small question about, I just want clarification on whether you believe that the GRC that is issued to anyone who is born in Scotland aged 16 or over will be available to anyone else living in the rest of the UK. So they're born in Scotland, but they live in the rest of the UK. What happens there?
So I guess there's two possible elements to the answer. So the So in terms of accessible to everyone else, the answer is no, because the gender recognition register is confidential. The legislation currently is formed anyway, places an obligation on me to make registrar generals for England and Wales and Northern Ireland aware of these activities, and that's we engage with our counterparts on a range of different registration activities, so this is nothing particularly new, but we'll obviously need to just build a process where we make sure that there's a flow of that information to the registrar generals in the other parts of the UK.
And that applies to if somebody applied from, say, an English prison. Is that the same system?
So the process, the responsibilities to make the Registrar General of England or Wales or Northern Ireland aware is where the person is from England, Wales, Northern Ireland, or is ordinarily resident there, but have applied in Scotland, if I recall from the legislation.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Moving then on to some issues around the prison service, can we start with Pam Gossall, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you for your opening statements. An FOI revealed that as of December the 3rd, 2021, there was 11 trans women held in the Scottish Prison Service, and that more than half are housed in female estate. Of those that are not, why is that? And are they without a GRC? And my question goes to James Kerr.
Thank you very much for your question. I can give you updated figures as of the 31st of March, actually. We currently have 16 people in custody. So that's the updated position for that. I mean, the crux of the approach that we currently take within our gender identity and gender reassignment policy is such that it's an individualised approach. So it's a case-by-case basis. Panel members will be aware that a person divulging whether or not they have a GRC is completely voluntary. So whilst we would ask them, they are under no obligation to share that information with us. So I think it's reflective, to answer the question, why people are placed where they're placed. It's based upon a consideration of a range of issues, one of which would be the GRC, if it's declared, and other issues would include the wishes and welfare of the person concerned themselves, a consideration of those that may live around that person, the placing of that person within the prison estate, not just the prison, but the actual hall or the residential setting within there, and whether or not self-sharing would be appropriate for that person, and also how that person would access services within that particular prison. So considering all of these issues would determine actually where someone was held. So currently I can tell you in terms of transgender male, there are 75% held within the female estate, 25% within the male estate. In transgender women, it's a 50-50 split. So 50% are held in the female estate and 50% in the male estate. And again, that would be reflective of the individualised case-conferenced approach to those people and their journey through custody.
Thank you, James Kerr. Just on the considerations you've spoke about, that one of the considerations are the GRC, which is whenever it's declared. We know that the Scottish Prison Service's gender identity and gender reassignment policy is currently under review and may well be revised to also give priority status, as it were, to the GRC holders. Those opposed to the bill believe that by removing the medical diagnosis of gender dysphoria, obtaining GRC will be significantly easier for prisoners. So the number of those with GRC and therefore entitled to be held in women's state will likely rise. Let me be clear on this, that this is about creating a balance between transgender-related rights and the safety and well-being of female prison population, protecting them from bad faith actors. It is about being fair to all. Do you think a fair way to maybe reassure female prisoners would be for an amendment in the bill to say that the GRC is not effective in prison allocations?
Thanks very much for that question. Panel members will be aware that it wouldn't be the Scottish Prison Service's position to comment on whether or not exemption should be applied to the bill or not. What I could say, though, is that the GRC, for most people, will be a significant life event. And given that ours is an approach which adopts a multidisciplinary, open, case-conferenced approach, that will achieve its ends best when we get full engagement by the person concerned. So providing recognition of a declared GRC status would ensure that we would do that. We currently don't see it being a major impact for us. As I described the numbers, 16 people against, I think we unlocked this morning, 7,409. And I would anticipate this year that we would see in the region of, and possibly in excess of, 15,000 people travel through our prisons on a daily basis. So even if there were an increase of people that asked for support relative to transgender issues, we don't see it as having a large operational impact for us.
Okay. And is the prison service ready for, if that increase does happen, that to provide that service?
We are ready to respond to if there is a potential increase in the number of people that do have a GRC status within the prison setting, yes.
Sorry, just one more, just to follow up on that. You talked about the consideration being that one of them on the GRC being declared. With, alongside that, would you be taking any other things into account as well, or is it, would you just be looking at the GRC?
No, GRC would be one, albeit important, element of the consideration. So, broadly speaking, we would consider the wishes and welfare of the person concerned, whether or not they had a GRC or whether it was a social gender issue. We would consider where they wanted to be relocated. Part of that consideration would be the welfare of other people in that location, whether it be men or women, and whether it be the male or female estate. Part would be access to services, and part would be cell sharing, in terms of whether or not a single cell occupancy or actually sharing with somebody that might be seen as a support and not a threat. Our wish would be that we could have a correlation between the well-being of others, the wishes and welfare of the person concerned, and the good order and of the prison and access to services, that they were all the same things. But where that's not, we would re-narrate a defendable decision around actually the best information that we have available at that point, covering a range of issues.
Thank you.
Robert, were you wanting to come in just to comment on that? Are you?
No, I think.
Okay. Fulton McGregor, please.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. We took quite a lot of evidence last week on the issue of prisons in relation to this bill. So credit to the clerks, you've come in at the right time so we can follow up what we heard last week by asking you about this week. And I think just following on from my colleague Pam Gossel's line of questioning there, one of the concerns that we heard was that the whole purpose of the GRC, of course, is to make the process easier. Do you think, and I know it's a theoretical question, might be difficult to give a full answer to, but do you think, based on your experience in the prison service, that you know, that more people will seek a GRC if this bill is passed, more people within the prison population?
Thanks very much for the question. It's difficult to absolutely predict in terms of the impact of the outcome of the bill if it does become an act. But as I said, I don't think, my assessment would be that we're not dealing with large numbers here, and we are confident that our current policy and our revised policy, which at this time we would anticipate would still take the approach in an individualised multidisciplinary case conference, it would be able to respond to any increases therein.
I guess the concern is more about, as well as the potential for an increase in applications for GRC, as you know, as has been mentioned earlier, bad faith actors. So people applying for a GRC, for untoward reasons, you know, to perhaps, increase the likelihood of being in another prison setting from what they're possibly in at that point in time. Do you feel that your procedures and policies that are in place just now are robust enough to deal with that scenario? And I think even our panel last week said it's not a likely scenario to occur a lot, but it could occur, and that's something that we need to be aware of. Are the procedures in place just now able to deal with that, even if this bill is passed?
What I would say is it's It's difficult to give an absolute answer to that. What I would say is that applying risk assessments relative to how we care for and manage people in custody is a well-trodden path for the Scottish Prison Service. So there is good experience and expertise across a range of professions that actually make those decisions. Might people try and use a GRC for nefarious purposes? Yes, that is one possibility. But the GRC is only one aspect the consideration that we would give the care of and placement of that individual in custody. So I would be confident that, as I say, our current approach and actually what we anticipate the outcome of the review being, in that it would still follow that individualised, multidisciplinary, open case conference risk assessment approach, being able to respond to that. I would add, though, that as panel members, committee members will be aware, risk assessment is not an exact science. It's a judgement call based upon the available information and facts that we have at that time. But as I said at the start, it's a well-trodden path for SBS, and we use it on a number of factors in terms of placing and managing people through prison.
OK, thanks. And just one final question, if that's all right, Convener. And I think that, you know, we've obviously spoke about the current policies within the prison service, and it's really good and reassuring to hear that. And you had all the up-to-date position as well, which I think was really helpful. But what do you think then that this bill, as you see it going through, does it have any impact on how you're going to manage the situation for people with a GRC, you know, going forward? And if it does, what is that impact, and are you confident in being able to manage it?
Thank you for that question. We don't think at this time there would be any major impact on our response and approach to supporting transgender people through custody. There may be an increase, a slight increase in numbers as a consequence of that. But as I said earlier, we're confident that we can provide a response.
Thanks.
OK, thank you. If we can go to Maggie, please.
Thanks very much. Just to follow up on a couple of things that you've said, and I don't know, Robert, it might be appropriate for you to come in here, but obviously that's up to you. You've mentioned that the gender identity and gender reassignment policy is currently up for review. Can you explain, is it just part of the periodic cycle of reviews that has led to the current review, or are there issues or concerns that have triggered this at this time? I'll come in on something else related to that, but if you could start with that. Thanks.
Thank you. The review was undertaken for a range of reasons. It was paused due to COVID, and we recommenced the review spring last year. And we went through quite a meticulous process to design the review, as it were, because we knew that the process was going to be as important as content. So we went through all the methodology design, who we were going to engage with. We commenced engagement with service users and staff in December, and the committee will be aware of that. We'd written to the committee at that time to alert you to the review kicking off. We're currently going through the engagement and evidence stage of the review, so we're not yet at the analysis and recommendations stage of the review. So there's a lot of maybe some questions that we're not going to be able to answer today about the review because we haven't conducted the analysis. But what I would reassure the committee around is that the extent of the engagement has included and learned the lessons from the previous review in terms of equality and impact assessment that was conducted at that time, and that we're engaging with staff, service users, stakeholders across a range of communities of interest and identity. I can't give you detail on the feedback from the review, but what, if the committee will permit me, I could give you some observations on what we have had. First of all, the spirit of the review has been really positive. I know it's interesting to see what happens online. I try and avoid it, but when you speak to people face to face, their humanity tends to take over. And you know, it's been a really positive, engaging review, and everybody that we've engaged with has been very constructive from across all communities of interest and identity. We continually need to improve the transparency and communications on this issue, not just as a prison service, but as a public body. We've taken steps to introduce quarterly data reporting on the transgender population as part of our wider reporting on equalities and human rights, and be happy to share that with the committee if you would like. So that's our role, to try and explain the reality of what is happening with transgender people in our care. And the third observation I would make is that there has been some real convergence points across the review. Everybody we've spoken to so far wants people's rights respected. They want risks to be managed effectively, and they want needs to be met. So in some ways, it's the divergence points tend to come when you look at how we achieve those things rather than what we want to achieve. And I think that's something that we're going to need to, that we're considering as part of the review process.
Thanks very much for that, Robert. That's really helpful. And I completely understand that you can't go into the analysis or recommendations because you're not at that stage yet. But I suppose just when the review was kicked off, paused, and then restarted again, was there any sort of sense that there needed to be a radical change to that a multidisciplinary, holistic risk assessment process as part of the policy, or was it just looking to see how generally things could be better?
We're a learning organisation. Yeah. We're always looking to see if we can do things better, and we have to do that. We've got a serious role to play in Scotland, and we take it very seriously. So it's incumbent on us to keep learning and improving. And the policy review seeks to identify if we can do it in a better way and in a way that's consistent with our obligations as a public body and as an executive agency of the Scottish Government and as a prison system. So that's essentially what we're trying to do. There were lessons learned from the previous policy development in 2014. Those are well documented. We've recognised that the equality impact assessment, for example, in 2014 didn't go far enough. I think that's recognition of the fact that we need to make sure that we're conducting it properly in this review, and we've mainstreamed it into the review. We're not leaving it till the end. We're encouraging that conversation about equalities and human rights as part of our engagement so that we can recognise the full impacts and how those impacts can be mitigated.
Thank you. And just finally, do you see any potential issue with what could happen, there being divergence in how the Scottish Prison Service deals with GRCs, gender reassignment more generally, and how things happen elsewhere in the UK? Do you see any problems if there does end up being divergence, given changes that have happened south of the border?
We've been engaging with other prison services as part of the review, and we've also looked at international experiences to see what we can learn from other prison services. We're really keen to learn and make sure that we understand the evidence and make sure that we can apply anything that would work better than the individualised case management approach. What we're looking to do is use all the evidence from our feedback from stakeholders, from our feedback from service users and staff, along with the wider evidence base, to assess what those policy options are. We will happily give you an update on that once we've completed that policy assessment exercise. But if we discover a more effective way of keeping people safe, meeting our obligations as a public body, managing risk and meeting needs of people, then that's what we'd be looking to do.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. My questions follow similarly to my colleagues Maggie and Fulton and Karen's as well. First question is, could you tell us a little bit about how many people in your care have requested a gender recognition certificate whilst they're in your care? Has that happened?
I don't have those figures with me today, but I'd be happy to share them with the committee if I can in writing after today's session.
Thank you. And then another kind of basic question as well, I guess, is around the can people who are currently in your care make statutory declarations?
In terms of the GRC?
In terms of any statutory declaration, are there any restrictions around people's ability to make a statutory declaration whilst they're in prison?
Can we check that and come back to you, and we'll provide that in writing as well after today's session.
Thank you. I'm not deliberately being difficult. I'm just keen to understand the likelihood, to be honest, of someone being in prison and then choosing that moment to
desired answer is to say no one's statutory rights and entitlements should be impacted on directly as a consequence of being imprisoned. Mm-hmm. But we'll check that and actually provide a written response to the committee after today's session.
Thank you, I appreciate that. That's helpful. We know that you're reviewing the policy just now, and thank you so much for setting it out in the way that you have and the detail that you have. We've heard last week in particular, but throughout the course of the evidence we're gathering, about some, I guess, undesirable circumstances that might have happened in prisons elsewhere in the UK. Are you able to say why it may be that that's happened elsewhere? And I'm assuming, because we haven't heard, that there are particular similar circumstances happening in Scotland. And if there are, it would be good to hear about that. What would you say is the reason that perhaps it's different in the Ministry of Justice to what's happening in Scotland just now?
I don't know if I can answer that, to be honest. I think we are looking at all the evidence that we can and as much detail as we can to see what learning is available across prison systems, mm-hmm. including colleagues south of the border. They have obviously a different approach to the way that we work. We respect gender identity for people in our care, but we also have to make sure that we're managing risks and meeting needs and understanding the evidence and available information to help us do that. I think there is a potential learning that we need to maybe gather from south of border and other prison services. So, for example, I know that they have a dedicated wing for transgender people in the women's estate south of the border. We don't have that type of approach. So it's about looking at that type of example and assessing whether that type of approach would fulfil our policy commitments, fulfil our policy intent in a better way than we currently do. So that would probably be one of the options that we would look at as part of the policy review. But it has to, I think we have to do it in a way that completely respects gender identity, but also takes into account the risks and needs, not just of the person involved, but others around them. And that's what the review is seeking to do. So we will share any lessons learned as part of the publication of the review.
Thank you, I appreciate that. Could you characterise for us the experience of trans people and how they're living in prison? I appreciate the numbers are very small, but could you characterise what their experience is and what the experience is also of the other women who perhaps are sharing the prison estate with trans people? How is that going so far?
That is one of the key areas of focus of the policy review, is to gather. We've undertaken interviews with transgender people in our care. We've circulated 400 surveys across the women's estate and across the men's estate, and we'll be supplementing that with interviews and focus groups just to unpick the feedback from across the women's estate and the men's estate. We've not done the analysis on that yet, so I can't give you the outcome of that. So there's no evidence to back up. Anecdotally, I wouldn't want to comment on that. Jim, have you got any?
No.
Thank you, and I'm nearly finished, if that's okay. Do you have any understanding of how it's working in other countries that have already got a self-declaration system, and what their approach to the prison population has been?
We're just about to do the analysis, so I can't give you the outcome of that, unfortunately. But I'd be happy to share that once that analysis is complete.
I was just going back on your earlier question in terms of the lived experience of people in our care. It's anecdotal, but if you look at the numbers and the spread, it would suggest that the individualised approach is actually working. So I think the committee might have heard in terms of the predominance, the consideration of GRC and its relativity in terms of where people are placed within the gendered estate, if you will. That's not our experience to date. And also the other comparison with HMPPS is the economy of scale issue, of course. Roughly speaking, they're 10 times the size of ours. So their footfall would be 10 times that of ours. So whilst it may be appropriate for prisons in England and Wales, they have, as Rob described, a wing for transgender people. I suppose the ideology that we're trying to do is to, for want of a better phrase, normalise people's experience as much as we can within the prison setting. And not every trans man wants to be placed in the male estate. Or not every trans woman wants to be placed in the female estate. That's our experience to date. And where we can safely accommodate that, considering the impact on the regime, the welfare of others, we would try to do that.
Thank you. I appreciate that clarification, and in particular the point around normalisation and then the differences between the prison system elsewhere. My final question is on, and you have kind of touched on this, but I get just for the record, I suppose, just now your gender recognition certificate is, and I think I've written down specifically, you said one part important, but it's one part of the process. Have you considered the legal effect of a gender recognition certificate? And in your policy review, have you looked at any legal advice that you've been given around the effect of that in future?
I think the convention prevents us answering specifically about legal advice specifically. But what we could say is that it would be normal practice for us as an organisation to take legal advice in terms of policy design, policy evolution.
Thank you. That's absolutely ideal. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Hamilton, please.
Thank you. It's just picking up on something that Mr. Kerr said regarding the allocation of prison accommodation. I just want some clarity around the Part 13. In the Prisons and Young Offenders Institution Scotland Rules 2011. How does that work with the policy that you have? So in those particular rules, it states that female prisoners must not share the same accommodation as male prisoners. But is it the current policy which states accommodation policy should reflect the gender in which the person in custody is living in breach of those rules? How do those work together?
The policy tries to fulfil all of our statutory and regulatory obligations in the right way, in accordance with the expectations of SPS as a public body and a prison service, including the prison rules and how they're interpreted. So it fully respects gender identity, but it also takes into account any risks or needs or vulnerabilities that we identify through the multi-agency case conference, and we do not see that as it's not our position that would run counter to a regulatory and statutory framework.
So does policy override legal definition within the rules itself. What happens if there was a legal challenge?
It's our position that a gender recognition certificate is a factor that we have to take into account when deciding on how to place and manage people in our care, but it's not the only factor.
So do you think then it would be difficult to challenge or override the individualised assessment that SPS would normally allow? So do you feel that you're going to be vulnerable to legal challenge?
We take legal advice as a matter of course on policy development, but I wouldn't be able to. I don't think I'd be able to answer that question.
Would it be possible for you, Mr. Kerr?
So, thanks for that question. I mean, as I was saying earlier on, a risk assessment, as panel members, committee members will be aware, is not an exact science. So, to answer your question, how would we respond to a legal challenge, or could that actually happen? Yes, of course it could, and that can happen in a variety of circumstances, and even where we place someone in a prison. You know, I think the committee heard evidence recently that prisons can be quite a litigious environment. People can raise legal claims for a number of different issues. Very few people want to be in prison, so it's an environment such that invites a challenge. I think it's right that any subjective decision in terms of the care and placement of an individual should be subject to challenge. But we have to ensure that actually the decisions that we take in terms of how we place and care for someone in custody is cognizant of all of the facts and information that we have, and that as far as we can garner at that time, that it's defendable. And then we would have to respond to any legal challenge thereafter.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Karen Adam, please.
Sorry, can you hear me now? Yeah. Yeah. Thanks, convener. Something that was raised last week at committee, and you know, often and crops up in the discourse, is sexual relations within prisons. So I would just like to seek some clarity on the position of the Scottish Prison Service and sexual relations and intercourse within prison.
And specifically around whether or not we think it happens, or what's our worry therein? Sorry to come back in terms of clarification.
Yes, both, yes.
Well, I think we'd be naive if we say that sexual relationships don't happen in a prison setting, irrespective of gender allocation, to be fair. But harm is a specific issue for us. So one of the considerations that we would undertake to assess when placing anyone in a prison would be that harm-related issue relative to sexual offending or sexual assault therein. So I don't know if that answers the question.
Yes, and also the policy when it comes to consensual sexual relations within the Scottish Prison Service.
We can take that away and provide a written response to the committee after today's session.
Okay, it was just my follow-up really was going to be on the back of that, how the bill as it stands at the moment, how that would affect any current policy within the Scottish Prison Service on sex and sexual relations.
Again, just to reaffirm what I said earlier on, we don't anticipate at this time the bill in its current form having any major impact in terms of our capacity to respond operationally to meet the needs of those in our care that have are transgender.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And moving on to some questions for Dr. Guyan, Rachel Hamilton.
It's your turn at last, Mr. Guyan. You've waited patiently. Okay, in your opening statement, you said that data should reflect experience and it should reflect who we are, who we want to be. You said there's too much data, and correct me if you didn't say that. I was a bit shocked when you said that, so I just want clarity on that. But my question to you is it your position that we should now only collect data based on gender ID and not data on sex?
I can respond to both parts of your question. So for the first part, my kind of statement on drowning in data, I do feel that around reform of the bill, there is a huge amount of data in support of reform. Just to signpost some of the work in that space, there's been two massive consultations, as most people will be aware, by the Scottish Government, with over 34,000 responses. Opinion polling has generally showed the public are in favour of reform of the Act, the most recent being a BBC Scotland poll from February this year, and also a huge amount of personal testimonies from organisations such as Scottish Trans. And I know that the committee had a private session earlier to again hear lived experience of that need for reform. So there is, in my view, an ample amount of data in support of reform and an argument to kind of proceeding and getting on with action rather than amassing more and more evidence of that demand. In regard to the second part of your question, at present, data is collected about sex in most situations, not gender identity. And the difference is in how sex is conceptualised in these data collection exercises. So in my opening statement, I mentioned that across the public sector, private sector, research exercises, questions are the vast majority of questions are about self-identified sex. So allowing respondents to answer the question as they wish, whether they're male, female, man or woman. Questions aren't about legal sex, they're not about biological sex, they're not about the sex on your birth certificate or your GRC. So I don't see any change in position or any change in the work that Scotland's doing around data collection at the moment. It's actually a maintenance of the status quo. There was a court ruling earlier in the year around the census in Scotland, and the Scottish Government were successful in defending their position, which ultimately maintained the same sex question in the census as was asked in 2011. So I don't see a departure in how we're collecting data. It's more of a continuation of how it's been previously.
So why is it that you have a different view to so many sort of senior quantitative social scientists who feel it's very important to collect clear data on sex? So, for example, we just spoke with a witness there regarding the differences between England and Wales and Scotland. So, for example, within the Scottish census, which you mentioned, the meanings of sex are different. And so, therefore, if National Register Scotland are then working with other bodies across England and Wales, how does that square?
Thank you for your question. So the difference between the censuses across Scotland and England and Wales follows a departure from the status quo in England, in the English and Welsh census, where the guidance for the sex question now asks respondents or advises respondents to answer according to the sex on their birth certificate or GRC. So this is a departure from how the question was previously asked. When we look at how people answer a sex question, whether it's a census or any other piece of data, any other data collection exercise, for the vast, vast majority of the population, estimated more than 99% of the population, whether the question's about sex or gender, whether it's about legal sex, biological sex, or self-identified sex, for 99% of the population, they will answer the question in the same way. So looking at something like a census, at a population-level study, those numbers we're talking about between the differences in approaches are really quite small numbers. With the census in particular, it relies on people reading the guidance as well. And some interesting research done by National Records of Scotland, ahead of the Scottish Census, showed that the vast majority of people don't read the guidance for the sex question. They just answer it. So I currently don't have concerns about any huge divergence in the numbers of the counts between Scotland and then with the rest of the UK. But I think what's important to reaffirm here is that the approach in Scotland is a continuation of how things have been. So if we look at longitudinal studies, data sets, large research studies in Scotland, such as the Scottish Household Survey, these are all self-identified questions that map up to the approach in the census. So if anything, the situation that's kind of departing from how things were is the English and Welsh census, not the decision in Scotland. To answer your first question about academics and researchers who differ in opinion to my view on the collection of data, I've worked in the space for around 5 years on a range of topics looking at gender, sex and sexuality, both in the UK and across Europe. It's been very uncommon for me to encounter other social researchers who think we should be asking questions about biology or birth certificates. The vast majority of social researchers operate research by asking a self-identified sex question. And there are a huge amount of academics, researchers, quantitative data experts who've also written open letters, who have written to Parliament, reaffirming that asking a self-identified sex question poses no risk to the quality of data collected. And I'd be happy to share with the committee an open letter from April 2021, where over 300 academics, quantitative data experts and scientists reaffirmed the benefits of a self-identified sex question.
OK, so, I mean, you've referenced the census quite a lot. Only 86% of people filled in the census, and there is concern that actually that data is going to be able to be, used in a quantitative manner, I suppose. It's a very difficult example to use in the current circumstances. But everything's based on data. For example, criminal justice data is based on sex, not self-identification. And so I think some people would be concerned in public bodies that there will be an impact. And I don't really agree with, what you've said. You also set out by saying that we do use data. So we use data here. We collected data and we used a consultation. 59% of those who responded disagreed with the principles of gender reform. So, we use that too. But how will the gender pay gap be measured? There's so many questions to be answered, and I'm not sure if I feel reassured by your argument that we just need to base everything on self-identification.
Thank you for your question. I think there's perhaps a misunderstanding about how these data practices currently take place. So with Police Scotland, they've recently reaffirmed, and with the court, they don't ask questions about birth certificates or biological sex in the reporting of crime, whether it's witnesses, victims or suspects. It is self-identified sex data that's collected in Scotland. Likewise, with your mention around the gender pay gap, again, this is self-identified sex data that is collected and reported for the gender pay gap reporting. This has been confirmed in recent guidance by the Scottish Government Sex and Gender Data Working Group, which advises public bodies how to collect data about sex and gender. In that guidance, the Chief Statistician and the Working Group confirmed that a self-identified approach to sex would be sufficient for equality reporting for the public sector equality duty, a position that was informed by a submission by the Equality and Human Rights Commission, which confirmed their position that self-identified sex data was sufficient for public sector equality duty reporting and reporting of the gender pay gap. On the point of the gender pay gap, I'd also like the committee, if you haven't already had the chance to do so, to look at a really fantastic detailed submission by Close Gap. In their submission, they test some hypotheses for what might happen if in different hypothetical situations, in their models, well, if some men were changed to women across a range of different organisations, and whether or not this would have an impact on the gender pay gap. And Close Gap in their submission highlight that these changes make no meaningful impact to the data, and particularly don't make any meaningful impact to how the gender pay gap is addressed. And the gender pay gap is quite a complex calculation. It can vary for a range of reasons. Staff turnover, for example, in higher levels can quite quickly fluctuate the gap between male and female pay. So I think with any of these exercises, it's vital we kind of scratch the surface and see what the data is really getting at, rather than assuming that that sex is the only thing we should be interested in as researchers and policymakers.
Just before Rachel comes back in, can we go to Paul Lowe, who's got a comment on this area, I think.
Can't hear you.
No, sorry, can't hear you, Paul.
Hi. Thank you very much, Convener. Yeah, as the Registrar General, I'm responsible for taking the census, so as there's been some commentary on it, I thought it would be appropriate just to note a few points. I think the first one is the legislative point. So to be clear, in 2011, the whole UK used a self-identified sex question And that was the intention of the Office of National Statistics as they went into their 2021 census. They were subject to a court challenge and an interim decision in the High Court of England and Wales ruled against their approach. And ONS took the decision not to contest that judgment and to amend their guidance. Importantly, as we talk about data, though, that came into effect after ONS had received millions of returns. So that change in guidance happened after quite a large proportion of the population in England and Wales had already submitted their returns using the existing guidance. Now, in Scotland, this case was subject to both a judicial review and an appeal, and our guidance in both of those cases was found to be compatible with the legislation. And the judges who are involved in those decisions noted that there was a wide variety of use and interpretation of sex and gender across a range of different pieces of legislation. So to be clear, there is a clear legislative position in Scotland around this issue as it relates to the census, and we've acted compatibly with the legislation. And I can't comment on a decision in a court in another part of the UK based on the information that they had, but it was an interim proceeding. It wasn't a full judicial review outcome in that case. In terms of the comments made about the data, I'm not going to pretend that I'm happy that I haven't got 90% plus in the census, but there seems to be great weight of interpretation that because we haven't achieved that, the census is in some way, I've heard various words, shambles and various other things that have been defined. And that's not the case. We're the organisation, you're the census taking experts. We've been doing it for over 200 years. We can produce a good quality census outcome with the 87% plus return rate that we've received now. I appreciate that this has been a source of speculation. So I commissioned an international panel of experts chaired by Professor James Brown from Sydney, who's a professor in official statistics there, and including a number of international experts, including the UK national statistician Sir Ian Diamond. Last week, they issued a statement saying that the census achieved a solid foundation and it was appropriate to move on to the next stages. Modern censuses are not just about the collection of data. That's kind of how it used to be done a long time ago. The last 30 years, we've been using census collection, we've been using something called a census coverage survey, which we're about to start running in Scotland, and a range of other statistical techniques to produce high quality outcomes. And we will use those, advised by the international panel that I've convened, to ensure that we provide high quality census output. So I just thought it'd be helpful to clarify those points as they've come up in discussion. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you.
Last point here. In 2004, the GRA, it was felt that there had already been an impact on the collection and use of the data because public bodies are either refusing or not collecting data based on sex. I'm wondering whether the bill in itself will exacerbate that problem, because do you agree that it could become a problem as we move forward? I mean, it's a difficult question because if you bring down the age to 16 and people's views and experiences are based on certain points in their life, whether it's a job or whether savings, pensions, all those sorts of things, there's a lot riding on this. And I just wondered whether you think that it's important that we, in light of our discussion here today, that you think that that data should be collected on a sex basis as well as possibly you're talking about there a gender basis, so that we actually can create good policy.
Thank you for your question. Are you, as a kind of point of clarification, are you able to say more about the impact of this kind of perceived negative impact of the GRA on public sector equality duty reporting? I haven't come across any sources evidencing that myself.
I think it's just referencing to the sort of specific examples I gave you, which could be that young people seeking help in gender identification clinics or gender pay gap, or all the other issues that I have raised with you today with regards to how we go through our lives in terms of that definition that forms public policy and creates services and provides help.
Yes, I can respond to that. So again, to go back to my opening statement and just to make the point again that how we collect data about sex in Scotland doesn't require a person to have or have not a GRC. Across all, whether it's work in the public sector, whether it's collecting employee data for gender pay gap reporting, whether it's being a participant in a survey or a research exercise, none of these questions are asking what's on your birth certificate or your biological sex or whether or not you have a GRC. So in my view, reforming the bill doesn't make any impact to how we're collecting data in Scotland at present.
OK. Does that have an effect on the prison service, Mr Kerr, if people haven't got a GRC? I know we've discussed that earlier, but specifically to Kevin's sort of point of view that, you know, we just don't really need to be collecting data on sex.
People are not required to no. divulge if they have one with us. And there was a comment made last week about perhaps SPS being blind to GRCs. We're not, and I can understand where that position's come from, but we're not blind to GRCs. We take them extremely seriously. We treat them with the respect that they deserve, but they're not the only factor that we take into account when we are looking at how we place and manage people. The reason we can't tell you how many people have a GRC is because people don't need to divulge that to us. We could, we have to respect people's rights. We don't collect birth certificates. We don't record birth certificates or that type of thing. So it's not something new for us.
Okay, thank you, Kevin. Yep.
Clarification to Rachel's point. I haven't did any point said we shouldn't be collecting data on sex. My point is we are collecting data on sex across a wide range of areas. It's self-identified sex that we're collecting data on.
Okay. Thanks for that clarification. And Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe. Kevin, thank you for your comments so far. I wonder, in your opening, statement, you talked about data not being neutral, and you mentioned in response to one of Rachel's questions the drowning in evidence for reform of the Gender Recognition Act. I wonder if you can comment on in maybe a little bit more detail around specific public policy areas. Rachel has touched on a few, but we heard a few weeks ago from the EHRC saying that we needed to consider how this proposed reform of the GRA legislation would have an impact both the collection and use of that data. And I wonder if you can just state maybe in a little bit more detail than you already have done, given the numbers that we're talking about and given what we actually use data for, the policy implications, what's the material policy reality of the bill as it currently stands, in your view?
Thank you. So I was surprised and interested by the submission from the HRC, both in their letter to the Cabinet Secretary at the start of the year and also in the oral evidence to this committee earlier in the spring. I was interested to see the reference to data collection as being a point of concern with the reform of the bill. I know in the oral evidence it was suggested that the differing judgments in the court cases around the Scottish Census and the English and Welsh census might have trickle-down effects that might in some way inform or shape the bill's impact on data collection. In my view, as the judgment in Scotland doesn't change the kind of the current practices, nor does it change how people with or without a GRC would respond to a census or any other data collection exercise, I didn't see the relevance of that concern for data collection in Scotland. In regards to your second point, which was around if you could just remind me again the second part of your question. So
the material reality, the consequences for policy terms.
So as kind of researchers and policymakers, it's really vital that we kind of ask questions that returns data that helps us solve problems. There's no one-size-fits-all model to how we ask about gender, sex, sexuality. It depends on the context. It depends on the communities we're working with. So as a researcher, I always aim to design a question and design questions that are robust, that are inclusive, accessible, and most importantly are going to engage the groups we wish to participate in our data collection exercise. There's no point undertaking a massive research project if your questions are going to be are going to dissuade people from taking part in that project. So I think with all of our work, it's vital that we think, who are we engaging with, and designing questions that are really both robust but inclusive. And I think that's the approach that researchers, policymakers strive to follow across social research. And that's why, as currently stands, across all areas of data collection in Scotland, a self-identified approach, whether it be to sex, gender, race, disability, sexual orientation, has throughout history been kind of proven to be an effective means of engaging communities in policymaking.
Thank you. And I suppose that point there about effective means in engaging people in policymaking, does that link to your point about, in essence, what data is for? We use data in order to inform and change society for the better, rather than it having any intrinsic value in and of itself. Is that more or less what you're saying?
That's exactly my point. So I think with a range of different areas where we could do research, particularly social research, whether it's education, housing, healthcare, across those areas in particular, it would be very, I can't understand the rationale for asking questions about an individual's biological sex or the sex on their birth certificate. But what we're really trying to get at are experiences of inequality, discrimination, difference, that are revealed through asking about an individual's lived experience and how they engage in the world. And as I said, this isn't unique to questions on sex. This is the approach researchers will follow for all areas of identity.
Thank you. I'll leave it there.
Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener. And thank you for that clarity on the value of self-declaration and data collection. Also, just before I ask one final question for today to yourself, I just wanted to also thank the other panel members, because I've found today really, really useful, and in particular from the Prison Service for setting out your considered, sensitive and normalised approach to this, which I think is refreshing. Thank you. The question I have is around how data and how you think data will be affected on the basis of, or sorry, how data on the representation of women would be affected by this bill.
Thank you. So looking across the kind of areas that I thought were of relevance to the committee, and that might be perceived to be some conflict or some impact between reform of the bill and the collection of data, I've mentioned a few of the examples around gender pay gap reporting, reporting of organisations for the public sector equality duty, research studies conducted by universities and research organisations alongside the census or any other future national data collection exercise. Across all of those areas, people are currently self-identifying their sex. I don't see from my work any impact across those areas on the bill as it currently stands, having any impact on how data is collected about women.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And if we could now go to Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, convener. And thank you, Kevin, for your evidence so far. I would just like to ask, you spoke about, you know, the amount of data that there was, and that there was an incredible amount of it. In regards to specifically this bill, what relative to other data gathering, how do you feel that the data is looking in a quantitative way, I should say.
Thank you for your question.
Relative to other data gathering.
Yes, this is there's been a huge amount of interest, a huge amount of engagement, a huge amount of consultation into this bill, both conducted by the Scottish Government alongside, as I mentioned, opinion polling, a huge range of lived testimonies from people who may themselves be engaging with any future gender recognition process, so both qualitative and quantitative data. Not to go through the details again in too much detail, but over 34,000 responses to the two consultations conducted by the government, alongside a range of exploratory work looking at international comparators as well. So going back to my point, what we're, the bill as stands is not an untested project. This has been taking place for 10 years in forums around the world, around a range of comparable countries. And looking at what the government have published on any evidence of the bill being used or being used in ways that goes against its intended meaning or having negative impacts on other communities, again, there is very limited, if any, robust evidence to demonstrate the negative impact in comparator countries where this has taken place. So both in regards to the existence of data showing the benefits of it, but also the lack of data showing the negatives of it. For me, there's really a huge amount of evidence in support of reform.
Thank you. Thanks, Julia.
Thanks for that. Thanks so much to all three of you, and all four of you for that really useful evidence session. We'll now suspend for about 5 minutes to change witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back. I now welcome to the meeting our second panel of witnesses representing faith and secular groups. So we have, and very pleased to welcome, Anthony Horan, Director of the Catholic Parliamentary Office of the Bishops' Conference of Scotland, Reverend Karen Henry, Vice Convener of the Faith Impact Forum, Minister of Yoker Parish Church and the Church of Scotland, and Chris Ringland, Public Policy Officer, Scotland for the Evangelical Alliance, and Fraser Sutherland, Chief Executive Officer of the Humanist Society of Scotland. You're all very welcome. I now invite you all to make some short opening statements, starting with Anthony Horan, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the committee for the opportunity to speak on this important matter today. The bill before the Parliament is part of a wider, intense public debate about sexuality and gender, which raises profound questions about human nature and the meaning of human sexuality. The Bishops' Conference of Scotland supports calls for all parties engaged in this debate to do so in a respectful manner. The Catholic Church's understanding of the human person and human sexuality is that sex is genetically, anatomically and physiologically fixed from conception. This understanding is widely held by people of all faiths and none. Yet whilst this is the case, since 2004 an individual has been able to legally change gender by following the process the Scottish Government now seeks to change. Therefore, even as we express our rejection of the idea that one can change sex, we accept that the legal ability to change gender and consequently sex on official documents is the legal framework within which we consider the bill before us. The Bishops' Conference of Scotland has serious concerns about the bill, not least the removal of the requirement of a diagnosis of gender dysphoria, the proposed reduction of timescales and reducing the minimum age for applications to 16 years. Gender dysphoria has been associated with low self-esteem, depression, and the taking of unnecessary risks. Studies have found that suicidal ideation and suicide attempts are significantly higher for those with gender dysphoria compared to the general population. To demedicalise the process as proposed in the bill would deprive a vulnerable group disproportionately affected by suicidality and comorbid conditions of much-needed contact with health professionals. Furthermore, the proposal to reduce the minimum age to 16 years risks bringing children into a process that they may not be equipped to deal with and which is lacking appropriate medical oversight. And we also share concerns about the impact of reform on single-sex spaces and the risk to the safety and well-being of people, especially women and girls. I appeal to the committee, which has an unenviable task of trawling through pages and pages of evidence and of ensuring a respectful yet honest debate on a highly contested issue, to keep an open mind. This bill is not without risk, and the public are concerned about that risk. The significant number of responses to the committee consultation opposing the bill, either in whole or in part, is testament to that. Every individual experiencing gender dysphoria should be treated with justice, respect, and charity. We must also be mindful of the vulnerability, highlighted by the high rates of comorbidities already mentioned. And this cannot be ignored.
Thank you. We can now hear from Reverend Karen Henry, please.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me here today. One of my Church of Scotland roles is to convene Integrity, our National Violence Against Women Task Group. This group exists to raise awareness and to help prevent the issue of violence against women. We approach all gender-based violence with a survivor-centred, faith-based and gendered lens. The rights and safety of women and girls as survivors of abuse, along with the safeguarding of single-sex spaces, have been used to justify arguments against reform. I want to be clear that Integrity is satisfied and convinced by the evidence offered by Engender, Rape Crisis, and Scottish Women's Aid, that the advancement of trans rights does not endanger women and girls or encroach upon their rights. We are concerned that the voices of survivors are being used in this way, which risks confusing vulnerable women and demonising another vulnerable group. Instead, we think that more needs to be done for all victims of gender-based violence. The committee will appreciate that the Church of Scotland is a large organisation which has a broad diversity of views And where there is rarely unanimity, I am confident, however, that the opinions represented in our written evidence and what I am here to say to you today do reflect the broad majority of views within the Church of Scotland. My final opening comment is to commend two committee members to read our publication, Diverse Gender Identity and Pastoral Care, available from our website. It helps to sum up our approach to this issue through the lens of supporting people who struggle against prejudice and discrimination. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And can I hear from Chris Ringland, please?
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity to give evidence today. The Evangelical Alliance is the largest and oldest body representing the United Kingdom's 2 million evangelical Christians. We were founded 175 years ago, and in Scotland we have relationships with Christian organisations and charities and approximately 500 churches with around 50,000 church attenders. Our members run youth clubs, food banks and debt counselling services working right across Scotland in some of the most deprived and affluent areas. They work with children, families, those with disabilities and those living alone, and minister to and serve those who experience gender dysphoria and those from the trans community on a daily basis. We commend the Scottish Government in its aims through this legislation to improve the lives of transgender people across Scotland. The trans community is one of the most marginalised groups in Scotland today and has been historically, and we recognise the role that churches have sometimes played in contributing to this. As Christians, we believe that everyone is made in the image of God and is therefore inherently worthy of love, value, dignity and respect. It is widely acknowledged that the current equality and human rights framework that we operate under in the Western world draws from its historically Christian origins. We do, however, have significant concerns about the bills currently drafted. Rather than improving the lives of those in the trans community, we're concerned about how the changing of the GRC application process could have unintended consequences to the contrary, as well as how the proposed process could affect the protected characteristic of sex under the Equality Act, children's development and pastoral care. In short, we think the current system is fair, balanced and adequate in how one obtains a GRC. And we know that this view is shared by the majority of the 10,800 respondents to the committee's call for views short survey response, with almost 60% of respondents disagreeing with the overall purpose of the bill, with similar majorities expressing concern for the bill's different elements. We're looking forward to answering your questions on the key aspects of the bill, but we also want to emphasise what the committee has strove to do throughout this legislative process, which we commend it for. The debate around these issues is far too toxic and harmful towards those it impacts upon, so it is our aim to be constructive, loving and respectful in every way, just like Jesus. Thanks.
Thank you, Chris. And now, if we can hear from Fraser Sutherland, please.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting us. As humanists, we're committed to treating individuals as having inherent worth and dignity and having the right to self-determination of their own lives and bodies. A move to recognising a self-declaration process for gender recognition is in line with humanist principles regarding the autonomy of individuals over their self. And we believe the proposals in the bill will make the process of applying for a gender recognition certificate better for those who choose to apply for one.
Thank you. Thanks all. We'll now move on to questions, starting with Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning, and thank you for your opening statements and the materials that you've provided in advance in writing. I've got a couple of questions around the diagnosis or the need for diagnosis around gender dysphoria and the panel, the medical panel that is currently in place with the current legislation. Anthony, I wonder if I could come to you first. You talked about there being a higher level of suicidal ideation and the sort of negative mental health impacts that many members of the trans community experience disproportionately compared to the broader population. And correct me if I'm wrong, but you attribute this, or you said something along the lines of you wouldn't want to see a lessening of engagement with or connection to the medical profession, psychiatric profession, and so would like to see the retention of that panel. Did I understand you correctly there? even though we've heard from people who've been through that process that they never actually speak to the panel, that there isn't that sort of patient-doctor relationship that you would expect, or that supportive relationship. It's just a body of evidence that is sent to and then assessed by, quite frankly, for the trans person, an anonymous panel.
Well, I think that then that is something that needs to be improved because, I mean, we can't hide away from the fact that, I mean, I think the statistics, and I think from your tone, you accept the statistics for trans people and in terms of comorbidities and suicidal ideation and suicide attempts and so on. I think given that is the reality of it, then I think more needs to be done to ensure that there is medical contact and appropriate medical contact. And it's certainly not the time to be removing any of that.
Okay, so I do accept that members of the trans community have high levels of suicidal ideation. I would not attribute that to the lack of contact with a medical panel, as in the current process. I would attribute that to a transphobia within society, more broadly. But I think just... If I can come back on that, if that diagnosis of gender dysphoria is required, then how would you see the GRC process applying to trans people who do not experience gender dysphoria?
Well, I think the key point is that I don't think you remove that process just because there are people who won't necessarily need to avail themselves of that and require that medical interaction. But the very fact that I think there will be people who require it, again, given those comorbidities, especially the case probably for young people, I would say, who are quite vulnerable in this regard, then I think that should be retained. I don't think it's the time. I don't know if it'll ever be the time, but it's certainly not the time now to remove it, given these statistics. And I think it's very, very... It could be potentially dangerous to do that. I accept the fact, I accept what you're saying, that there will be people who don't necessarily have a diagnosis of gender dysphoria, but the point is that you capture the people that do have gender dysphoria, and they are then given the appropriate support and treatment, if indeed that is required, but that will be down to medical professionals.
Okay, I mean, the diagnosis itself is a current requirement, so it doesn't capture those who don't experience gender dysphoria, so the current system doesn't serve a proportion of the trans community who does not, who do not have that diagnosis, so we are not... Mm-hmm. supporting them at all with the current process, which I view as problematic. And given the lack of engagement of the panel with the individual, there isn't that medical support there. I think I agree with you, there needs to be support provided, but I'm not sure through this process is the appropriate way. Karen, can I come to you on this? And is it your clear position that diagnosis of gender dysphoria is actually problematic, and that its removal, you've stated you welcome that removal. What would you see as being legitimate or necessary evidence or criterion for the new process?
We would consider that, in line with the World Health Organization, who have said that transgender and diverse gender identity is not a mental or behavioural disorder, the natural outworking of that statement is that the diagnosis needs to be removed. We feel that this is not a medical issue, that the people that are transgender, that are experiencing their lives through different diverse gender ways, need to be listened to. And they have the knowledge and the expertise within they're living this within their own skin and their experience, they're living out in the world. And we need to be a listening ear. I think there needs to be a pastoral response, a caring response, and a valuing response of the individual. I think that would be our main concern.
Thanks very much for that, Karen. Chris, if I can ask you, you mentioned in your opening statement the concerns around the impacts on other protected characteristics of the bill as it currently stands. Can you just say a little bit more about that?
So we'll kind of come to that through other questions as well around different aspects of the bill, but just to touch on the demedicalisation aspect. We do want to recognise that every trans person's experience is different, and I think that's come through your question as well. But our concern around the way that the bill is proposed is the potential unintended consequences actually on the trans community itself, in terms of if that is one of the main ways in which it's assessed as to how someone obtains a GRC, then that potentially opens it up to people misusing the system. Not those who you described as those who don't experience, just as in, I think, bad faith actors, or the type of that we've described before on the committee. So I would defer to the NHS in terms of what, if gender dysphoria is seen as inappropriate, like what would be appropriate. I would note how and ask how this fits in with the interim report of the CAS review as well. And also just to say, from a European comparison perspective, in the Netherlands, their gender recognition system requires supporting expert opinion, and the vast majority of EU member states like Croatia, Finland, Germany and Sweden all require supporting medical documentation. So we wouldn't be necessarily out of step by keeping some aspect of medical documentation as part of the process.
Okay, thanks. And Fraser, finally to you, around this medicalisation of the process, you stated in your opening remarks that autonomy is really, really important. How do you see the medicalisation interacting with that notion of autonomy, if at all?
Well, I think on this bill, you know, this is about a legal process rather than a medical process, and I think it's important that we keep that in context, that there's potentially two approaches here, that there's regulated medical support for people who need it, but there's also this legal process, which I see is quite something different. I don't see the need for the diagnosis, essentially, would be my answer for the legal process. I don't think it's helpful. I think it brings us in line with other European countries who've moved to a self-declaration process, like Ireland and Denmark and Malta. Part of the humanist movement, what we champion is people's personal autonomy over their self. And I think them being able to make that decision for themselves is quite important.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And a brief stop from Karen Adam, please.
Sorry, Commissioner, issues with a microphone there. I would just like to ask, on this, the opinions of the panel, when you came to the conclusions of those opinions, was that after you had engagement with any trans members of your religion or organisations, or any trans community organisations?
Okay, and I guess just kind of quick answers. Just Anthony first.
Yep, I mean, most of the evidence that we have is drawn from a number of studies over a number of years, which has involved, obviously, transgender persons, but we haven't spoken specifically to trans people in our community.
Okay, thanks. Can?
I would refer back to our Diverse Gender Identities and Pastoral Care booklet that's on our website. It's actually collating people's life stories in their own words, and it's a resource that we have made available for our congregations to discuss this. And
brilliant, thanks, Chris.
Our membership interacts with the trans community in all their services, and we're attempting to represent them today.
Okay, thank you, Anne Fraser.
Yes, but specifically on this particular issue, we sought out external support as well as the internal membership, including trans members of the humanist community. We spoke to academic specialists in family law, transgender support organisations, children's rights specialists, as well as looking at published evidence from the World Health Organisation before developing our position on the government's review, which We did back in 2017 when this was all started. Yeah.
Right. Thanks very much. And can we now go to Fulton McGregor, please?
Okay, thanks, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I've got two questions around two provisions in the bill, and that's the provision to live in the acquired gender for 3 months, and then secondly, on the proposed 3-month reflection period. If I could ask about the provision to live in the acquired gender for 3 months, we've heard quite a lot of evidence suggesting that this is unnecessary, both from those who are generally for or support the bill and from those who have got concerns about the bill. I'm wondering, and I'm happy to take any order, but I'll just go with how we've been going so far, maybe start with yourself, Anthony, but I'm just wondering what your thoughts on this specific provision are.
Yeah, I mean, we don't have a medical scientific view on this because we're not that kind of organisation, but my concern, and it follows on from the answer I gave to Maggie Chapman earlier in terms of the evidence of elevated risk of depression, anxiety and suicidal ideation and so on, that any reduction in the time frame, I think risks a failure to provide the space and support for people who are impacted by gender dysphoria. And on the face of it, 3 months does just seem remarkably short for a decision of such magnitude.
So I probably... Thanks very much for that answer. Before I move on to the other panellists, I should maybe expand a wee bit. And I hope I'm not misquoting either side of the debate. And I don't think that I am, but generally speaking, I think that those who are in favour of the bill generally and the provisions worry that this is unnecessary because people have been living like this for a long time, and 3 months, whether it's 3 months or 2 years, this is a big life changing decision. And those with some concerns about the bill are maybe concerned about the term acquired gender more and how that could be actually defined. So maybe should have given that a wee bit more explanation before coming on there. But I do appreciate your answer, Anthony. But Reverend Carnhenry, your thoughts?
Yeah, I would pick up on your last point there. The Church of Scotland doesn't have one view about whether there should be a 3-month living in your acquired gender, as it's been termed in the bill. They do, however, want to query the language of acquired. There's a thought that you don't acquire a gender, it's inherent within you. And there's a process of revelation of being comfortable in your own skin. So we would want to ask if the committee could perhaps revisit that term, acquired, and look at something that maybe reflect a transgender person's reality a bit more. Our only concern for... Do you want me to go on to the reflection period?
I'll come back to that, as I say, if that's OK.
That's fine.
Well, thanks very much for that. And Chris and Fraser, have you got anything to add to...
Just briefly, we think the current requirements for living for 2 years is sufficient, but we also do acknowledge what has been said previously by witnesses. And I think one of the previous witnesses said they waited 4 years for an appointment at a gender identity clinic, so we do recognise that, but we think that's all the more reason actually to keep it at that, even though we also think it seems like in 3 months or 2 years it's arbitrary in one sense. But the reduction to 3 months with the removal of providing other forms of evidence leaves it open to unintended consequences that would negatively affect the trans community. And we also would just want to put in the record as well, in light of the CAST review, which we may come back to in later questions, that's a reason why it should be kept to 2 years as well, because of if we're going to reduce it to 16-year-olds as well.
OK, thanks, Chris. Fraser?
Just picking up on the point that Karen made around the need for the acquired gender, I suppose there's a slight problematic point on that that suggests there's some kind of gender norm or gender roles, and it plays into this idea that people have to fit in a specific kind of, what evidence is that going to look like, that you're going to be able to show that you're fit in with this category? And I wonder if that's slightly problematic for some trans people who are, you know, who may not fit that classical view of what that looks like. On the waiting period, I'm not sure that when we've read the documentation from the government that there's strong evidence as to why there's a need for a waiting period. And I asked the Cabinet Secretary when we had a faith and belief round table with the Cabinet Secretary as to what the purpose of the waiting period is, and there's still not really any evidence being given as to why they feel that's necessary. I don't feel that's been robustly explained as to what the purpose of that is, other than people might change their mind, but people might change their mind in other legal contracts that we don't insist on a statutory waiting period. So if there's evidence as to why that's a good idea, then I'd like to hear it, but I don't think we've heard it from the government yet.
Yeah, thanks for that, Fraser. And then moving on, and I'll do it in reverse this time, if that's all right, to be fair. The 3 months reflection period, which I think you were going on to touch upon there, about, again, we've heard some concerns about that. We've heard some concerns that it's perhaps quite demeaning for trans people to have a reflection period, you know. But then on the other side of that, we've heard that perhaps the reflection period isn't long enough, particularly as I think you were talking about there, or one of the panels talked about when it might come to younger people who are going through a lot of different changes in their life. So I wonder if you can give us your views on the 3 month reflection period as proposed. And as I say, I'll start with yourself, Fraser, this time.
I think really the fact that the process has this requirement for a statutory declaration, I feel like that's quite a strong ramification that's coming from that decision that people are making. So I struggle to understand that it's something that people are rushing into all of a sudden and they're making the decision. The fact that they've probably come to this decision over a protracted period of time before they've even entered into this process, to then set another, you know, you put this application in and then you have to wait another 3 months and then kind of almost complete it, suggests that people haven't put a serious thought into it. And like I say, there's other, you know, there's other big legal changes that people can make in their lives that don't require that kind of enforced waiting period. So I'm not sure that we've heard the evidence strongly as to why that's required.
Okay, thank you. Chris, you got anything
to add? Yeah, I think the diversity of views is reflected in the responses to the committee's call for views. I think it was nearly 40% agreed with the reflection period, nearly 35% disagreed, and 25% didn't know if they agreed or not. So I think that is, that was quite different, I think, to the other questions that were asked about the bill. Just to put on the record as well, we note that Denmark's legislation has a six-month reflection period before legal recognition is granted, and Belgium also requires a period of reflection. So just a bit of that.
Okay, thanks for that. Yeah, Karen?
The Church of Scotland feels that this is generally a good idea, that it emphasises the seriousness and legal formality of the process. It's a self-declaration that someone is making, and it gives time to reflect on the permanent nature of being granted a gender recognition certificate. We're not sure why 3 months. We would encourage the committee to perhaps tease that out some more and give some background as to why 3 months is the figure that has been chosen. We would also be concerned that during this 3 months that it's not simply a downtime waiting for a letter in the post, that there's how are people enabled to reflect during this time? What support are they given so that this time is a positive time of waiting and enabling a person to be who they feel themselves to be?
Yeah, thanks very much for that. And just a supplementary on yourself before I move over to Anthony, you've always asked us to tease out where the figures come from, and I think that's a very reasonable ask when we have the Cabinet Secretary in front of us. But I'm wondering, do you or the Church have your own view on that? Do you think that the 3 months is just a bit right or too short? Or
the only concern we would have is for those who were younger We feel it would be right for 18-year-olds, but if it was someone coming in 16, we would consider that a reflection period should take them up to 18 years. We're saying that because 18 is it's noted as the year that UN Convention of Rights of the Child defines that a person becomes an adult when they reach 18. And that we're also noting that England has raised the minimum age for marriage to 18. And you'll know better than me, but Scotland may follow that also. And there are other indications of the difference between 16 and 18. Armed Forces is 18. And there are reasons why 16 is not treated as an adult in the justice system, in the criminal justice system. So these are things that would impact our thoughts on this.
Okay, thank you very much. And Anthony?
Yeah, thanks. Study suggests that the majority of young people with gender dysphoria will desist and become settled in their biological sex, as much as 85% in a study from 2016. So in that sense, a reflection period would appear logical. But the fact that it's time limited, I think, is raises questions about other provisions in the bill, and I suspect we might come on to that later.
Thanks a lot. That's me, Convener. Cheers.
Thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. And good afternoon to the panel. Thank you for your answering the questions so far and also for the information you've submitted in advance. It's been really helpful. I kind of have a couple of sort of follow-on points from what we've heard. And specifically on the time period, and some have said it's remarkably short for a decision of such magnitude, I think was specifically how it was put. But we've heard a lot from LGBT people that it's usually the end of the process for them applying for a gender recognition certificate rather than the beginning of a process. And that they have been thinking about this thing for a significant period of time, so much so that I think the example you gave, Chris, if it's okay, of Denmark, I think Denmark are one of the countries that are considering no longer having that period in it. And I'll be corrected on the record if I'm wrong on that, but I think it was one of those countries. So what is your response? What's the panel's response to LGBT people who say this is the end of the process? We've already spent a lot of time thinking about whether or not we want to change our gender.
First, no, absolutely, and we completely acknowledge that. I think just our concern generally, which is a recurring theme throughout different aspects of the bill, is just that the way that it is currently drafted potentially leaves the door open to people misusing it who aren't from the trans community, because there's no requirement. It's the false application offence is kind of the main barrier to that, to stopping that. So it doesn't necessarily need to be 2 years, it could be shorter than that, but it's just having it as 3 months with nothing else, with the other different aspects of the bill that we'll touch on, is where our concern is around for the trans community and other people misusing it.
Thank you. Could I just ask a quick supplementary on that, if that's okay, Chris? Thank you for that. That's helpful. What is the evidence that you have of people using it for bad acting purposes?
So we don't necessarily have evidence for how this would work in practice in this regard, but it's just in making legislation, even if we expect that to be, of course, a small number of people who would potentially do that, or if that is the case, even the fact that it could be a possibility is something that the bill should seek to stop. We assume that the committee would agree with that as well, that from people misusing in that sense. It's just because of the way that it's just the false application, which we'll come into, I'm sure, in other questions as well.
Thank you. Do other panel members have any comment on the time period? Further to what you've... Anthony?
Yeah, I mean, I can understand what Chris is saying about the potential for bad actors and you know, trying to put people off, I suppose, you know, with a longer time period. I take the point that Pam Duncan-Glancy put forward in terms of some people seeing that as the as the end of the process, you know, given the length of time, but maybe that's something that the government needs to consider, some of the just some of the other areas that maybe isn't covered in the proposed legislation, where the process could be improved. I just go back to my point that I made earlier, for risk of sounding like a broken record, it's just that the evidence that we've seen in terms of the comorbidities for that community, and particularly for people with gender dysphoria, is very, very concerning, and it's something that we need to be wary of. The causative effects of that are still largely unknown. In fact, I think they're very unknown. In that sense, much more research needs to be done in order to find out exactly what it is that's causing these comorbidities in this community.
Thank you. I share your concerns about the suicide rates and actually in general of the poor health outcomes for trans people across Scotland and the UK in general, I think are a concern for all of us. I don't know that this bill is specifically the place to address that. Could you see any other routes that we could use to address it so that perhaps we could work with the people who the current process doesn't capture, the people who are not gender dysphoric? Is there any other way that you think we could make both work together?
I'm not sure. It's not something that I've thought an awful lot about, but I suspect that there are elements of the process that sit out with this bill and out with legislation generally that could be improved. I think Chris Ringland spoke a moment ago about an individual who'd experienced a 4-year wait and therefore, you know, I guess that's something that could be improved by just looking at the process rather than actually needing any kind of legislative change.
Thank you. Can I just turn to Reverend Karen Henry and your comments, that your opening comments were really powerful and strong, particularly around the impact on women and the integrity group of people that you described. And we've heard some discussion today, but also in previous sessions, around worries about bad actors, and you were quite strong on your view on that. Could you tell us a little bit about how you've come to that view and what your view on bad faith actors in this legislation is?
Well, a crime is a crime. This bill, anything man-made, I don't think is going to totally be waterproof against a crime being made. That is a different issue. I don't think this bill, that is the core purpose of this bill. I think integrity is focused on violence against women. The Church of Scotland has particular concerns. The Faith Impact Forum, which I represent also, has concerns of speaking for the marginalised and the prejudiced and the victimised as well. And I think there is clear evidence that transgender people do experience more violence. We have figures from various research that suggest that trans women are twice as likely to experience sexual assault than cis women, and 47% of trans people have experienced sexual assault. So we're also concerned about discrimination and how, as a society, we can learn to live better with difference.
Thank you. That's really, really helpful. And does anyone else have any further points? And then I just have one other question, and that'll be. Thank you. The last question I have is around the some of the comments that we've had in submissions, and including from yourself, Anthony, around parts of the bill affecting reassignment surgery or irreversible interventions. Could you tell us a bit more about what you mean by this and how you came to these conclusions?
Specifically on the point of reducing the age from 18 to 16, is it?
Yeah. Yeah, and yeah. I think your point was that it's irreversible and around it conflates the point about reassignment surgery as well.
Well, I mean, I think in terms of children, I think that there are, you know, there's good reasons to protect children from making permanent legal declarations regarding their gender, and also good reason to question opening up a pathway to puberty blockers and cross-sex hormones and other potentially irreversible treatments and surgery. And the long-term effects of a lot of that remains unclear. And that's really our concern, is that I don't think the science is necessarily settled on that. And therefore, I think that's something that we're really concerned about. I mean, there is evidence that, just quoting one study, that much is still to be ascertained about the impact of medical intervention. And I suppose that applies actually to adults as much as it does to children. So that's a really, really important thing that we need to think about. And particularly in relation to children, you know, I think we've also said in our evidence that you're not allowed to get a tattoo at 16 and 17 years of age. And that's something that's only skin deep. But attempting to change one's sex, I think, goes much, much deeper. And therefore, I think it would be incongruent to have that an ability to get a tattoo, but at the same time you can change your gender.
Are there aspects of the bill that you think make this process irreversible?
I think what making it, I suppose, simplifying the process and particularly removing the requirement of a diagnosis for gender dysphoria, I think potentially does set individuals on a particular path down which there is an increased likelihood that they will, for example, in terms of children or younger people, you know, maybe entertain puberty blockers before that point, and then they entertain cross-sex hormones, and then they go into surgical intervention, which is generally irreversible as far as I'm aware. And therefore, there is evidence that that once an individual has engaged in that process, started puberty blockers, basically, then the vast majority will continue on through that process, going on to cross-sex hormones and then going on potentially to surgery. And so there is a danger there that some of that, at least, could be irreversible.
I don't have any evidence to suggest that wouldn't be irreversible, so I couldn't dispute that. But I wonder, what part of this particular legislation puts someone in the process of accessing puberty blockers?
I think there isn't anything specific on that.
Okay.
It's not kind of direct part of provision within the legislation. However, as I say, that the removal of the requirement of the diagnosis of gender dysphoria, I think potentially just makes it easier and therefore opens up that pathway where people could go down that route and that process that I referenced. I think it increases the chances of young people who would normally, and we've seen evidence of that, normally desist from their gender dysphoria and become settled in their biological sex. It increases the chances that they will go on and potentially engage in irreversible elective treatments or surgery.
Do you think that maybe, sorry, convener, this really is my last question, do you think that maybe could be a reason to decouple the medical process with the legal process then, so that people aren't immediately put down a medical path which could result in the what you've described?
I do think that I still maintain my argument that the medical process and the medical oversight should be retained for the reasons I outlined earlier.
Thank you.
So I wonder if anybody else wants to comment on, there's a kind of a bit of an area there, so it would be probably useful if anybody else.
I would like to just comment that perhaps the committee could emphasise something that our Faith Impact Forum and the Church of Scotland came up with, that this is not a self-ID route to medical treatment or surgery, and that perhaps that needs to be emphasised.
Anyone else?
Just to very, very briefly put on the put on the record around that area of detransitioning, just to refer the committee to reports and statements from Europe recently, from the Swedish National Board of Health and Welfare and the National Academy of Medicine in France, which I think followed that, just about this whole area. I would implore the committee to explore that, and also just around the area of the false declaration. If the bill as currently stands is to reduce it to 16 and then someone detransitions later on in life, we don't think that that should be criminalised. And then, but that's not part of the provisions in the false applications. It's just we'll come to that later, I'm sure. But just the
Fraser, do you want to?
I don't have anything major to add on that, really. I think at the beginning part I said about it was a good idea to decouple the medical and the legal process. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. If we can now hear from Rachel Hamilton, please.
Thank you. Morning, panel. So the first question is, can you explain your views on the provision in the bill to lower the age for a GRC from 18 to 16. I'm going to start off with Reverend Hendry, because obviously we've heard that the Church of Scotland agree with discontinuing mandatory assessments, but they don't agree with lowering the age from 18 to 16. And I wondered if I could get your views, please.
Yes. It's really to reflect the wider context that 18 is regarded by the UN Convention of Rights of the Child, defines the child as a human being under the age of 18. And there are other markers for when a person reaches 18. There is a transition from childhood to adulthood. We note that the minimum age for marriage in England has risen now to 18, and an expectation that Scotland may follow. There's also a minimum age for armed forces that we would support as 18. And criminal justice system, a 16-year-old is not treated as an adult within that. We are of the opinion that a self-declaration requires a degree of maturity that perhaps is seen more in an 18-year-old than a 16-year-old. We're not saying that you would not engage with a 16-year-old. Our approach is absolutely pastoral, and we would consider that a 16-year-old would have an extra period of reflection until they reached 18.
So just to develop that questioning, on the if, for example, the government reform went through and all the suggestions, all the policy reforms were, you know, passed in the Parliament, would you feel uncomfortable on your position of removing a need for an assessment and then not supporting the lowering of age to 16? I accept the arguments that you have made, by the way. How would you feel about, how would the Church feel about that?
Of removing the medical diagnosis?
Yes, but it going to 16.
We would be happy with the removal of the medical diagnosis. We would be concerned about it being lowered to 16.
So, on, I'll come to the other panel members in a minute. But who does the Church of Scotland engage with to come up with the policy positions that you are coming up with today?
The Church of Scotland has two main forums, the Faith Nurture Forum, which is looks in the way concerned with the internal dynamics of the Church of Scotland, and the Faith Impact Forum, which is about looking out the way into the world, and I'm vice convener of that. The forums are made of people that have identified skill sets that are required to engage and explore relevant news situations, subjects that the Church is engaging with.
I have looked at your Faith Forum. I wondered, you mentioned in your opening remarks that you mentioned in gender, you mentioned Rape Crisis Scotland. Who else has the church engaged with to form opinion?
On our integrity group, which I convene, we have a professional violence against women worker. We have engaged in a stakeholder day where we have gathered information from interested parties as well. So we've done a fair bit of conversation, information gathering. Our main focus is to listen and to understand and to respond in a pastoral way.
Okay, can I extend the question to other panel members? And let me ask Fraser.
On 16 and 18. Yeah. So we would agree with reducing the age to 16. I was listening very closely to what Karen was saying on the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. I don't feel like I agree with her assessment of how the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child works and capacity judgments of how young people or how it is judged that young people reach a capacity age. And I would draw very much the attention to the evidence you heard from Bruce Adamson on this topic. I think he covered it very well in terms of how a capacity is judged for young people. If you look at, for example, the Legal Capacity Scotland Act, you know, young people are able to make even life and death decisions about medical treatment at end of life, which shows that the system can be adopted, which protects the best interests of them as well as their voices equally. So I'm not sure that I would agree the assessment that UNCRC dictates that everything has to be 18. That's not my understanding at all from what legislation has been produced by this Parliament or by using the United Nations Convention either. I also think that, you know, you heard earlier from evidence from Vari Crawford, I think in one of the previous evidence sessions, she gave you a very clear number of examples of lived experience of young trans people that I think would be very well listened to, not just by the committee, but by the wider Parliament as well.
It's strange how law works, isn't it? And regulation, you can't get a credit card until you're 18. You can't place a bet. You can't get a tattoo. You can't drink alcohol. There's strange rules and regulations for 16 to 18-year-olds. Chris, could I bring you in, please?
Yep. So we would definitely think that until the CAS review concludes that it shouldn't be reduced to 16 and then see what comes of that, because the interim report said that young people's gender identity can remain in flux until their mid-20s. And I'll defer completely to medical professionals on those points, but it seems reasonable that it should be pressed ahead with reducing to 16 with that being known. kind of with those different aspects that you just mentioned, Rachel, we're not clear as to why it would specifically be 16, considering those other aspects of law that you can't do until you're 18 in Scotland. I think the legislation in Ireland has also been referred to by in the committee previously. So for their gender recognition process for 16 and 17-year-olds, it requires an application to a government minister, a court order process, parental consent and medical certification from two doctors, so a medical practitioner and a psychiatrist or endocrinologist, that you have transitioned or are currently transitioning into your preferred gender. So I think it's worth maybe the committee reflecting on that or hearing from an Irish representative on the specific point of 16 and 17-year-olds. And I think, for the record, that's under Section 9 of Ireland's 2015 Act. Belgium requires parental consent and a report from a psychiatrist for 16 and 17-year-olds. And I just echo as well about the recent decision from the UK government to legislate about marriage. So they've raised the minimum age of marriage to 18 rather than 16 to tackle forced marriages. So that has the inherent implication that 16 and 17-year-olds are more vulnerable vulnerable in different ways, so to speak, to 18-year-olds.
Yeah, Anthony.
I segued a little earlier in one of my answers to Pam Duncan-Glancy, and so I've maybe covered part of the ground already on this, but just to add to what I did say earlier, I think the magnitude and consequences of such a decision raises the question whether a child, and I align myself with what Karen Henry said about the the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, defining children as those under 18. Whether a child can give informed consent, especially in the formative phase of their social development. As you mentioned yourself a moment ago, in Scotland, young people under the age of 18 years are restricted by law in terms of buying alcohol, tobacco in licensed premises, and buying or possessing fireworks, watching any film they like, or, as I said earlier, from getting a tattoo. And again, I repeat that a tattoo is skin deep, but attempt to change one's gender goes a lot deeper than that.
Chris, you mentioned the CAST review, and we know that that is at its interim report stage at the moment, because in England they've seen a significant increase in the referrals for children and young people to gender recognition clinics. You seem to have quite a strong view on the importance of the CAST review. Do you think that this bill in Scotland should be paused until the CAST review publishes in full?
I think that would be reasonable, but also I'm conscious that I think the points were made many times about how long this process has been going on for and the amount of consultations, but I think that the findings, even just from the interim report, are very important kind of in the thinking around this bill. So,
does any of the other panel members have a view on the CAST review and how important it is, particularly in the context of what we're doing in Scotland? No? Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Pam Gossall, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, panel, and thank you for your opening statements. As you'll probably be aware, if someone wishes to choose the sex of their nurse or doctor, they are free to ask so. For example, if a female goes into doctor surgery and is getting a smear test done, she can ask to be if it can be completed by a female doctor. They have the right to ask for that. If a doctor or nurse is transgender and a patient is not aware of this, and as we've heard from many witnesses before, that there's no requirements to disclose this information to the patient, this could interfere with religious practices whereby women are not allowed to be touched by men. This is of great importance to many, especially from the BAME community. I raised this concern last week, and I really do have to put it on the record and make this very clear for everybody listening. At no time am I saying that the trans rights do not matter, nor am I saying religious rights do not matter. This is about creating a practical balance between two sensitive area, rights and liberties. These are concerns that have been highlighted to me by many. I understand that this may not be the practice that is in every single religion, and maybe not in the religions that you represent. However, it'd be great to hear from you from religious organisations that you present, if this is a concern for you or a woman of faith, and whether there are other concerns regarding the practical implications of self-ID and that the committee may not have heard before. And can I ask Karen first, please?
Yeah. We haven't discussed this as a forum, but religious belief is part of a protected characteristic in the Equalities Act. So for the BAME community that you're speaking about, I would expect their religious belief to be respected when they are interacting with medical profession or any other. I would expect their belief systems to be respected. Yes. Uh-huh. That's...
Thank you, Karen. Anthony?
Yeah. I think the bill proposals do open up the possibility of legally changing gender to a larger number of people. And I think with that comes potentially an increase in the likelihood of bad actors abusing the system for their own ends, gaining access to potentially for example, women's refugees, safe houses, changing facilities in prisons. There's already examples of this, particularly in the prison system. And that's not to tar all people in this community with that brush, but it's just that there may be people who want to use the system for their own nefarious ends. And that's very, very concerning. In terms of... I think it's incumbent upon the Scottish Government and the Parliament to ensure that those who express the view that sex and gender are immutable and thus reject the idea of gender as fluid and separable from biological sex are free to do so. I think that needs to be protected. I think that's particularly important for those who work in education, healthcare, marriage celebrants, prison staff and religious representatives, among others. Certainly from a Catholic Church position, I would argue that we should be able to declare the marriages of people in accordance with our own teaching, which is something that's already protected and it should be preserved. And I think that's obviously the case also for the teachings of other religious bodies and groups as well. Freedom of thought, conscience and religion, free speech, freedom of expression and association, all of these fundamental freedoms constitute a precious inheritance that must be preserved and passed on intact to future generations.
Thank you, Anthony. Chris?
I think it's important again to put on the record, religion or belief is a protected characteristic under the Equality Act alongside sex and gender reassignment. And I think this is the sort of thing maybe that the Equality and Human Rights Commission was referring to about its concerns about a conflict possibly of rights in certain aspects in situations maybe that you've referred to, Pam. So I think that is worth exploring a lot more, and I would defer to them about that.
Thank you, Chris. Fraser?
Yeah, so I suppose my perspective is that the situation you were describing doesn't arise from this particular bill. It already exists. That situation could already exist today. And the NHS often provides sensitive services to people of religious communities, and I think they're capable to do so with this specific issue, and they obviously do at the moment. The NHS has a long history of being very aware of and sensitive to individual religious beliefs. If you look at their guidance on treatment, for example, blood transfusions and people who refuse to accept blood transfusions for religious reasons, I have no reason to believe the NHS would have a huge difficulty in doing the same for this particular issue. I think from our perspective, any healthcare should be provided on an informed consent basis for the patient, and so I think that's the right way to get about it. Just pick up on one point that Anthony said about not portraying it as a group of people that are a particular risk. I think there's an important thing to say about how we strengthen protections against individuals who are a risk, but without implying that a whole category of people should have their rights restricted in order to achieve that. I don't think history is very kind on that perspective when we've restricted whole communities, whether that be religious groups, racial groups, on the basis of bad actors from that group.
Thank you, Fraser. Just on that, you're absolutely right that it's already the case that transgender doctors don't have to inform the patient of their transgender status. As this already is a gap in the law, wouldn't it make sense to address this issue now and bring balance between transgender rights and religious liberties? This bill is an opportunity, perhaps the prime opportunity, to bridge that gap. That proposed changes under the GRA would make it easier to transition and obtain a GRC. This may create a situation whereby the problem becomes more widespread, having a greater impact upon the faith communities and their right to practice their religions.
I mean, like I said before, I think it should be on the basis of informed consent, and I think it's for the NHS to put in the guidance and the regulations to achieve that.
Can I ask the same question back to Anthony and Karen as well about the gap that's in the law right now and moving forward with the new legislation?
I think just that the Parliament, as I said, needs to be cognisant of that balance between potentially... those competing rights is maybe the right way to say it, but certainly where there maybe tensions exist. So I just think really just I would repeat what I said earlier on and just say that, just make sure the Parliament is cognisant of that.
Thank you. Karen, is there anything you want to say about obviously the gap in the current law?
I would just reiterate that go back to the Equalities Act and the protected characteristics. I think that we were of the view that the Equalities Act protects situations like that, and religion, belief is part of that and already protected.
Thank you. Chris? Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much. Can I go to Karen Adam, please?
Thank you, convener. I'm thinking I'd ask this question to all the panel, if that's okay, if I can start with Anthony and then move right along the panel. We've heard that as trans people continue to have almost no visibility in public life, and whether that's in boardrooms, council chambers, churches or parliaments, it's hoped that any trans person who has felt unsure about applying for a position on a Scottish public board will be encouraged to do so with these reforms. What's your response to this? Would these reforms change how you would proceed with the requests for trans people to be in leadership or decision-making roles within your organisation?
That's not something that we've specifically considered, but getting back to basics, every human being is, in our understanding, is made in the image and likeness of God. And all human beings are to be respected. They all have dignity. And we have to meet people where they are. Whilst our concerns about an opposition to the reforms in this bill are well known, we obviously recognise that there is absolutely a pastoral duty on the Catholic Church, and in particular to and all sort of religious organisations in particular, to make sure that all individuals, whatever their sexuality, whatever their status, are welcomed into our communities. Saying that, there are protections in place and under the GRA as it currently stands, in terms of the appointment of priests, for example. And I mentioned earlier on about the Catholic Church and our particular vision of the marriage between one man and one woman, and that's something that should be protected.
Karen.
Thank you. I would turn the committee's attention to our Equality, Diversity and Inclusion programme that is looking at what it means to state that all people are loved by God. This is our faith perspective, and all people are welcome. What does that mean for us as a people of faith? In our the website, Diverse Gender Identities and Pastoral Care that I refer to, we do have real stories of, I think one of them is a trans male who is giving his life story. He is a leader in a Christian church. Also in the Church of South India, they have just ordained their first trans woman. They have been running a transgender programme in the Diocese of Madras for some time now. So this story of what this of what it means to be human, what it means to feel loved, feel valued, what it is to be an inclusive community that can hold the ground respectfully for everyone, and open a space of grace-filled listening so that there can be a move to understand one another is something that the Church of Scotland is actively involved in.
All ministers and pastors within our membership seek to love their congregations well and support everyone fully in their spiritual lives, and that absolutely includes those from the trans community. So it's in our membership's interest and the whole of Scotland's interest that how this legislation works, that we get it right, and for the benefit of everybody, regardless of who they are.
Your question, Karen, was very much about, you know, our organisations and how we implement, you know, changes regarding this bill. I don't know that there's anything specific in this bill that would impact any of our internal processes or anything, you know, in terms of people joining as members or taking up positions within the humanist organisation. But I do accept probably the point that you made, Karen, about people being more willing to be open about their identity, and so therefore we might have people who are already involved that are not open about their identity, and perhaps this would be more comfortable for them if they were able to access the as the bill proposes.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks, everyone, and thanks to all of our witnesses to this panel. It's been a really useful session for the committee. That concludes the public part of our meeting, so we'll now move into private for the final items on our agenda. Thank you all very much.